Good evening and welcome. I'm Terry Sanchez, program specialist here at the Newport Beach Public Library. It is my privilege to get to welcome you here tonight to our Meet the Author event. I want to make sure that I take the time to thank the Friends of the Library. It is because of their generous sponsorship that we are able to host outstanding authors like our guest author this evening. So thank you to the Friends. If you haven't already, I'd like to ask you at this time to silence your cell phones. Well, we are very excited to present our guest author this evening. Nabil Ayers has traveled here from New York. He's in town to attend the Grammy Awards on the 5th of February and was gracious enough to fit us into his schedule while he was here. So we're super thrilled. Mr. Ayers has thrived in the music industry for over 30 years. He was the longtime general manager of 4AD Record Label and is currently the president of Beggars Group US, their parent company. He also founded the independent record label, The Control Group. As a drummer, he has performed in several bands, including The Lemons, Tommy Stinson, and The Long Winters. At age 25, he opened the iconic Sonic Boom record store in Seattle with a business partner. It became a local treasure and quickly grew to 3 locations. They sold it to a longtime customer in 2016. He has written about race and music for the New York Times, Rolling Stone magazine, GQ, Pitchfork, and NPR. We are just thrilled to have him present his memoir, My Life in the Sunshine, just published this last June, which centers around his lifelong journey of navigating his distant relationship with his famous father, Roy Ayers. He writes with sincerity and transparency and a matter-of-fact voice, displaying remarkable and thoughtful observation from a very young age. Please join me in welcoming Nabil Ayers.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay? Does this sound all right? Thank you, Terry. Thanks for having me. Thanks for coming. This is crazy. There's a lot of people here. And before I forget, I need to thank my new cousin, in air quotes, Jamie, who I just met last year for the first time, who lives very close and who set this up. So thank you. So this is a book talk. So I'm going to read a little bit from my book, but not too much because that gets boring. But there's a sort of multimedia thing coming up. But I'll read the introduction because I assume there are a lot of people here who haven't read the book and it's an introduction. So it'll help you get some context. So this is called Straight Outta Compton. It actually takes place in Los Angeles, this part. When I see a movie theater advertising Straight Outta Compton, I know how I'm about to spend the next 2 hours. What better setting, I think, to watch a blockbuster about the LA rap group NWA than this? The city from which it emerged. It's the summer of 2015, and I'm in Los Angeles for the FYF Music Festival, where backstage I am repeatedly mistaken for a newly famous video director who has also made music videos for Kendrick Lamar, Kanye West, and Frank Ocean, and goes simply by his first name, Nabil. When I'm introduced to some people, it's telling to hear their voices suddenly become more hip-hop, attempting to drop a bit of street into their words. An affectation they adopt only when they think they're meeting the rap video director. Not That Nabil always elicits a humble apology. People aren't aware that even though he has made videos for hugely famous black artists, Nabil is half white and half Iranian and looks much more white than I do. While I was hoping to spend today at the festival with the artists I work with, instead, I slowly walk around the newly revitalized downtown Los Angeles, recovering from a terrible case of food poisoning. The thought of seeing Straight Outta Compton in a comfortable air-conditioned theater is much more appealing than the sensory overload of a crowded music festival. I force down the rest of my banana, guzzle my remaining seltzer, and still feeling weak, buy a ticket to the matinee. Compton begins with a bang. In 5 fast minutes, the Los Angeles police destroy a drug house. Bullets and expletives fly, vicious dogs bark, and armored vehicles smash through residential walls like they're made of paper. And I'm completely sucked in, happy to have my mind numbed by Hollywood action, even if the portrayal is devastatingly true to life. The bombastic opening scene ends, and the ensuing silence is broken by a piano sound, followed by an unmistakably familiar, lazy synthesizer melody. My pulse suddenly feels very present in my body. The song's patient, buoyant pace drives the camera's slow movement, which reveals a bedroom adorned with posters, records, DJ gear, and eventually a teenage boy lying down with his eyes closed and headphones wrapped around his head. The character, meant to be NWA founder and producer, Dr. Dre, wears a Los Angeles Dodgers jersey and hat as he subconsciously airplays the piano, the congas, and the synthesizer along with the song. That's funny. The overhead shot shows a record spinning and a legible red Polydor label at its center. The scene, which contains no dialogue, does everything to convey that Dre is lost in the music. The camera closes in on Dre, surrounded by album jackets, and I brace myself, knowing what I'm about to see. And there it is, one album, standing apart, with its white border, a man in a tight yellow t-shirt, a beard, and an afro stands against a bright yellow background. His hand rests confidently on his hip, and he smiles as he looks off camera, radiating casual conviction. I can't read the album title, but I don't need to. I already know the man on the cover. The music is so loud that I physically feel it in my chest and ass. The lyrics offer the first voices in the scene. My life, my life, my life, my life, in the sunshine, blasts from the modern theater speakers, and the chorus of male and female voices further shakes my weakened constitution. I am alone in a dark movie theater, 3,000 miles from home, feeling skinny and sick and completely caught off guard by the most famous song by my father, Roy Ayers. Everybody Loves the Sunshine was a moderate hit when it was first released in 1976, but it's grown over time. It's been sampled more than 100 times by various artists, including Mary J. Blige, Common, J. Cole, Tupac, Snoop Dogg, and Black Eyed Peas. It's been covered by D'Angelo and Chibo Matto, spanning decades and constantly refreshing itself into modern context. I've heard it in many different iterations over the years, a perennial, persistent reminder of my otherwise absent father. After one long minute of music, Dre's mother surprises him by turning off the record, which snaps him out of his meditative state. My chest feels hot and my breath is short. My first reaction is to sink into my cushy chair and look around the theater to see whether anyone is looking at me. Is this what it would feel like to run into him? I wonder. I'd last seen my father 9 years earlier when I was 34, but that had been planned, a lunch in Seattle, my first ever meeting with him as an adult. The time before that, when I was 11, I had no idea who he even was. Since moving back to New York City, where he lives, I'm always slightly, subconsciously on guard, ready to run into him, but I definitely wasn't expecting it in a dark movie theater in Los Angeles while getting over food poisoning. Though my father and I live in the same city and are both in the music business, our paths have never crossed in the 7 years that I've lived in New York. Occasionally, someone asks me how he's doing. It surprises me every time, and I usually respond with something like, "You'd probably know better than I would," which feels confrontational and often leads me to quickly offer a slightly apologetic, less biting explanation that he's never been a presence in my life. How, I wonder, did a hippie child in New York City who never knew his father become a grown man who still didn't know his father but encountered his music regularly? Were moments like these truly coincidental? Or had my father's DNA guided me into a life in music and ultimately to the places where his presence caught me off guard? It has been over a year since I last tried to contact my father, and though I was unsuccessful, I decide it's time for another try. I know he won't become the father I'd never had, but maybe he can become the father I meet for lunch once or twice a year, the father who tells me about his life and my family history, the father who texts me each year on my birthday. He might not respond, but even if my father ignores me, I will have tried. Little do I know, in that moment, that the impact of that minute in the movie theater, the intensity of hearing my father's music, my music, in a public place through huge speakers and staring at his picture on a giant screen, will be the catalyst that opens up 2 centuries of perspective on my family. Thank you. So now we move on to the slideshow, which is sort of a walk through the book. Let's see, let's hope this works, the AV. That's me when I'm about 2 years old. All I wanted to do was play drums and listen to music, and I was encouraged from an early age to do so, and as you can see, I was really into it. I loved it. That's me and my mother around the same time. This is in New York City. When my mother was young, 20 years old, she met my father at a jazz club and immediately said, "That's the person I want to have a child with." And to be clear, she didn't say, "That's the person I want to marry," or "That's the person I want to be with." She said, "That's the person I want to have a child with." She knew she wanted to be a young single mother. She was super focused on that. And I've always known that story. So my father's never been part of our lives. She said to him when they were dating, I'm using that term loosely, she said, "I want to have a child. You don't have to be part of our lives. Will you do that for me?" And he said, "Yes." So this agreement has always existed. I've always known about it. And it's always been me and my mother. That's my uncle on the right. He's a jazz saxophone player named Alan. Incredible musician, equally influential in my life, maybe not through DNA as my father is, but through purely presence and being there. He's the one who bought me a drum set when I was 2.5 years old. We used to play music together for hours on end. He would practice, I would play drums, he would play saxophone. And in 1975, he made a pretty incredible, really avant-garde, deep jazz record called Valley of Search. And I'm gonna play just a minute of a song. Let's see if it works. I always find myself looking at it as if something's gonna happen, but it's just a photograph. So that's Alan's apartment in Lower Manhattan. If any of you know New York City, it's at 501 Canal Street, which is at the time was called the Lower West Side by the Hudson River. This building, Alan, when he went to Berklee College of Music in Boston, he and some friends who graduated moved back to New York where he grew up, moved into this building. The entire building, the red brick one in the middle, was $500 a month. They each paid $125 a month for their entire floor. I know, it is crazy. And all they did was play music. They were all musicians. None of them worked. They, you know, scraped by, did musical things to make that money. And I remember I spent a lot of time there as a kid, and it was incredible. It was just this musical mecca. It was a total dump. There was no heat. There was no air conditioning. And New York was so much hotter and so much colder back then. But it was really just this kind of magical place that was just filled with these wonderful people who played music all the time. And I got to be around them. Of course, now, that building's not there anymore. But it's Tribeca, which started, I think, late 80s, early 90s. It's one of the most expensive zip codes in America. That's my father, Roy Ayers. And this is the cover of the album that came out in 1976, Everybody Loves the Sunshine. As I mentioned before, I've never known him. I ran into him a few times as a child. He's alive and well. I found out today he's playing in Los Angeles on Saturday, which makes for some very awkward thoughts and things we can talk about after this. But I'm going to play a little bit of this song. I'm curious how many people know it by name and then recognize it.
Sunshine. gonna skip down in the sunshine. Sunshine,
yeah.
Folks get brown in the sunshine.
Do people know that song? Recognize it? Yeah. So when I was 5, my mother and I moved to Amherst, Massachusetts, where she went to finish college at UMass and get her MBA. And we lived in what I would call a project, but it was this really idyllic place. It wasn't what you think of as a project. It was about 200 families, all that were affiliated with the university somehow, whether it was professors' kids or students' kids. And we paid $45 a month for this great two-bedroom apartment. We were on welfare, we were eating off food stamps, but everybody there was kind of in the same situation, so it just felt normal. I was totally a normal kid. I had a black father and a white mother. None of that mattered. It was kind of everyone was in the same situation. It was this really amazing place. Of course, there's lots of talk about diversity these days, which is why it's in quotes, and I suppose that's a good thing, but in Amherst, it just wasn't a topic of conversation. It just existed. It was this really magical place where so many kids and adults were of different races and different mixes, and it really wasn't even talked about that much because there was no dominant race to sort of be the same as or different than, if that makes sense. Tons of kids with single parents, tons of kids without a father. I was really a completely normal kid in Amherst. It was an amazing place. That is the album Destroyer by Kiss, which changed everything for me. Until I was about 5, I listened to a lot of jazz. We had my father's records, of course, all the music that my mother and my uncle played, a lot of jazz artists, but I remember seeing this in the UMass bookstore and seeing that cover and thinking, oh, well, that's my new favorite band. There's probably people here who have that feeling. And I studied that record so much, I learned the fan club address by heart, I read the lyrics, I was a crazy Kiss fan as a kid. And when I was 7, my mother took me to see them at Madison Square Garden in New York City, which really just solidified for me, I was already a drummer, and that's just, I had to be in a band. I mean, I'd been to lots of live music concerts by then, but never anything of that magnitude with the crazy lights and the explosions and the fire. It was very great. And that's the result. That's around the same time. And there's a lot going on here. This is not just me wearing Kiss makeup. I mean, at the time, a lot of those records we listened to, my mother had a really diverse collection of records. We had lots of records by black artists and white artists and other races. But I remember really thinking that I kind of didn't look like Stevie Wonder. He had a much tighter afro than I did, as you can see, that's kind of a mess, and much darker skin. And the Beatles, of course, had pale skin and brown hair that I knew I'd never have. And I think there was this thing, as a kid who wanted to be in a band, I wanted to identify with the people that I saw on the back covers of the records I owned, and I couldn't. And strangely, Kiss was that band. And of course, I knew that they were some white guys from New York. But the makeup and the costumes made it so that it was attainable for me. And so I thought if I put on this makeup and did it, I could be in Kiss. It was a huge influence. When I was 10, my mother and I moved to Salt Lake City, which was much different than New York. A huge culture shock. She worked for American Express, she'd finished her MBA, and they moved a big part of the company there, and so we moved out with them, and suddenly I was definitely a very different kid for the first time. Very family-oriented city, I think 1.5% black at the time, lots of, everybody had two parents, lots of people had 3, 4, 5 siblings, and so it was very strange for me to be this biracial kid with a single mother who swore a lot. And I heard these questions for the first time. Can I touch your afro? Are you poor? Where's your father? And they didn't seem overtly racist to me, and I didn't think that kids were doing it to be mean. I think they were generally curious because they'd never encountered anyone like me. But it was hard, and it was really strange, and these are things, I spent these 10 years truly fitting in and being a normal kid and suddenly started getting these questions in Salt Lake City. And for me, music really helped get through this. And I don't mean sort of sitting and like getting deep into lyrics about feeling sad. It wasn't that. It was more that I used it as a tool. As a 10-year-old, I had a drum set, I had a guitar, I had a much bigger record collection than any 10-year-old in Salt Lake City, probably anywhere. And so I'd have friends come over after school and try to start bands and try to teach them songs, and we'd watch MTV and all these things that I used that as my strength. And instead of being defined by the things that made me different, I really leaned into music and let that kind of decide who I was. And so By the time I was in junior high, we were kind of blending in. I'm getting pretty preppy here. I've got a polo tie on. My mother's wearing this 80s navy blue corporate suit. And I would still spend every summer in New York City, which looked like that in the 80s, hanging out with Alan and, you know, seeing movies that weren't open in Salt Lake and eating really good pizza. And I would spend the rest of the year in Salt Lake City. That's some high school prom photo. It's pretty easy to tell which one I am. And I was more into music than ever in high school. It's a really incredible time. There's so much great music out, and I started to realize that they're all white artists, no matter what kind of music I liked with them. It was very much about you had to like metal or new wave at the time, and I really liked both. But all the music, at least that I was discovering from the radio and from MTV and from my friends, were by white artists. And there was a point towards the end of high school where I discovered a band that really changed things for me. Let's see if this video plays automatically. It does. That's the band Living Color in 1989 on the Arsenio Hall show, which used to be a show. And I started to discover other black rock bands that I was really excited about, like Bad Brains and Fishbone. And similar to when I was a kid, it's not so much that I identified directly with these people, but it really opened the door in my head to the idea that you didn't have to be a white person with long hair to be in a rock band. You could look different, and there are lots of bands making great music who did. So I graduated from high school in Salt Lake City in 1989, and when I started thinking about what I wanted to do and where I wanted to go to college, my mother took me on a few trips. We went down the West Coast, went to California, went to Washington, and I think in Seattle, there's just something about it. I could just tell it was a musical city. I didn't know what was coming. I didn't know about Sub Pop Records, the label. I could just tell that everyone there looked like they were in a band. There were tons of record stores. Every pole on the street had a flyer for a show. It just felt like the place I wanted to be. And so in the fall of 1989, I started college at the University of Puget Sound in Tacoma, which is about 45 minutes south of Seattle, beautiful, small liberal arts college. And my timing could not have been better. Someone who was into music, 1989 was an incredible time. During the first semester of my freshman year, Nirvana and Soundgarden and Mudhoney, all these bands released records. I was right in the middle of it. It was easy to see those bands. We were driving to Seattle and going to clubs all the time and seeing them, buying records. I was a DJ at the college radio station. It really felt like I was getting so much closer to music. It was a really exciting time. There's a point in my junior year, in the spring of 1991, there was an open call to go be in a live concert scene for the band Alice in Chains, who was a huge Seattle band at the time, still a big band. And Cameron Crowe was shooting a new movie. It turned out to be the movie Singles that came out 30 years ago, which is crazy. But my friend and I drove up to Seattle to try to be extras in the movie. We looked around, and everybody looked like that, which we did not. And we're like, we're never getting into this. What should we do? We've driven to Seattle, so we found the paper, and it turns out a band called Nirvana was playing that night. And they were a big local band in Seattle at the time, but never mind, the big album was not out yet. They hadn't recorded it. But we knew about them because we went to college and DJed on the college radio station. So we paid our $8, went to this show in a club that was definitely smaller than this, like a teeny club that was packed with 250 people, and saw this show, which is definitely one of the best shows I've ever seen in my life. It turned out to be the first time they ever performed Smells Like Teen Spirit. And there's a clip of that performance.
The song is called Smells Like Teen Spirit. We'll be right back.
I still get excited when I see that. It was really crazy to have been at that show. And I remember leaving, and I went to so many concerts then, and when I would leave a concert, especially one that I loved, I remember thinking like, oh, my friends and I would be so excited, and we'd be talking about the set list and what they played and the order and how they did it. And I remember leaving that show, I was just with one friend, and I was 19, and I felt terrible. My arms felt kind of numb. My stomach felt like it was this weird pit. I had a little headache. I felt kind of depressed, which never happened to me for any reason, let alone from seeing one of the best shows I'd ever seen. And when I was in the car, I think I realized what happened, and it was this heavy thought that they just ruined music for me. I really felt like the show was so powerful and so good that I'd been wasting the entire 19 years of my life with everything I'd ever seen or listened to, and that everything was total shit, and I would never be into music again because of this 1-hour-long set. It was really, really powerful, and I definitely, definitely wanted to be in a band even more than ever after that. It's a big night. Turns out, I learned later that they got in the van the next day to drive to LA to record Nevermind. You can tell he didn't even know the lyrics yet to Smells Like Teen Spirit. So towards the end of college, I was supposed to be reading and writing and thinking and doing those things, but what I was spending most of my time doing was DJing at my college radio station, planning parties, playing in a band. I was an intern at a record company. It's everything that really led to what I'm doing now, but at the time I felt guilty about it. I graduated with like a 2.2 or something like that, and all my friends thought I was a slacker, but really I was actually on the right track. But I had to make what I think was the biggest decision of my life, which was to work at a record store or to get a real job. And this is in 1993 in Seattle. It wasn't hard to get a real job. All my friends who graduated college went to work for Microsoft or Boeing, or like even then early tech firms were starting. All of them got jobs, they got nice apartments, they bought new cars, they took me out to dinner on their corporate credit cards. And I knew that if I did that, it would stop me from being in a band, and that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to be able to tour and to leave town and play drums. So I got a job at a record store. It's called Easy Street Records, it's still in Seattle. I don't know if there's any Seattleites here, but a great store in West Seattle. And it was incredible. It was almost like grad school. I was there for about 2 years, and I learned so much about the music business. I heard so much music just from all the other employees that played stuff. I met tons of bands. I met all the people who worked for the record companies. It was really an incredible, it was like grad school, an amazing experience. And of course, I fell into a band, and I had to cultivate this new look, because now I was in a rock band, so. I got my cool glasses, had some little, I don't know, dready Brady things in my hair. Sideburns, probably fake leather jacket. This is a band called The Lemons. And these guys had been a band for a couple years. I sort of knew them, and I happened to be in their manager's office when he hung up the phone. He was really upset, and I was like, what's wrong? He's like, The Lemons drummer just broke his arm, and they had this huge show in a week opening for Mudhoney, who was like one of the biggest bands in Seattle at the time. And I said, oh, well, I can fill in. And we got super lucky because they had a week, and I knew them, and I knew the song, so we went and practiced, played the show, and the first time I ever played with them was at Seattle Center, right under the Space Needle, that sort of iconic spot. There were 6,000 people there. It was really, really fun, and the plan had just been to play that show, but broken arm guy never came back, and I ended up staying in the band, and since they'd been around for a little while, things happened pretty quickly. And by the next summer, we signed a contract with Mercury Records, who happened to be the label that Kiss is on, which was crazy. So suddenly, I'm 23 years old, I'm living in Seattle, I'm playing drums in a rock band that's signed to a major label. So everything's going great. And we started touring a lot. And it wasn't glamorous. That's a picture of a van, not a bus or a plane, in case you can't tell. It's the four of us and maybe one or two friends, depending on the situation. Packed into a van with all of our gear, we'd drive around the U.S. and tour for like 5 or 6 weeks, drives, you know, 6, 8, 10 hours a day. We would share motel rooms or sleep on our friends' floors or sleep on the couches of people we met. It really wasn't glamorous, but it was tons of fun. We were all 23. We got to open for the Circle Jerks and Joan Jett and so many artists that we loved. It's an amazing experience. And we also went to jail. We were starting a tour from Seattle, we played LA, and the next show was supposed to be in Salt Lake City, but between Los Angeles and Salt Lake City, we got pulled over, and there was a lot of pot in the van, which was illegal then. I don't know if anyone is aware. California, right? Because it was such a long tour that the guys in the band who smoked pot, which really were not me, brought a lot because they didn't want to have to deal with finding it in every city, and it was a 6-week tour. So the police found all this pot. put us in jail. It was possession with intent to distribute. It was a felony charge in the early 90s, which is not a good time for that. So suddenly, I'm handcuffed on my knees in the desert on a median, and I remember thinking over and over again to myself, the mantra in my head was, but I went to college. Like, somehow that was going to protect me from going to jail, but it didn't. And I ended up in jail for the day, but it was the first time that I really thought that I made the wrong decision, and I was imagining my friends and their nice apartments and their corporate credit cards and their new cars and all these things, and here I was, literally behind bars, handcuffed in jail. It's a very long story, but to make it short, because of my connections in Salt Lake in my high school years, we hired this incredible attorney who came and completely wiped the slate clean. And it's really crazy to be on both sides of that within a few weeks, the side where you're handcuffed in the desert with felony charges, it's very scary, and the side where you can pay somebody to come in and just make it go away, which is also very scary and incredibly fortunate. I have a stack of paperwork from the state of Utah that says you've never been arrested, we are so sorry. It's really crazy, but yeah, it was wild. So, the lemons never really blew up, but I had a great time. When I got back, I was still working at Easy Street Records, and my friend Jason was also working there, and we decided, we were 25, it was time to start our own record store. Seattle was still a relatively inexpensive city. And so we had the idea, and we went to a bar one night, and this isn't the napkin, but this is what we wrote on the napkin. This is our business plan. We decided that we needed to make about $5,000 a month. Those would be our expenses. Rent would be $1,500. The loan payback, we borrowed about $30,000 total, would be about $1,500. We'd pay ourselves $1,000 a month total. That's two people, two human beings in Seattle, $500 each. Miscellaneous would be $1,000, whatever, insurance and other costs. And to make that, we would need to, this is how we broke it down. We'd need to make about $166 a day, which would work out to about $16 an hour, which in the end we thought, well, that's two CDs and one record. And we were like, wow, that we can do that. That seems fine. And we did. And we opened a store called Sonic Boom Records in September 1997, God, over 25 years ago. And it was incredible. It was a really small space, like maybe this area here. It was the main floor of a house in a neighborhood called Fremont in Seattle. And the first couple of years were really hard. There would be hours when nobody would come in. We would just listen to music. We were always worried about going out of business and really almost did. But our neighborhood is great. It was this incredible community with lots of other independent businesses, and we kind of all took care of each other. People would trade us lunch for CDs, or if we were really short on rent, which we were all the time, we'd bring some CDs to the guys at the brewery, and they would give us a keg, and we'd have a party. And all of our friends would come and buy tons of records, and we would literally have the money to write the rent check the next morning. Like, it was really hand-to-mouth. And this is at the time when, I guess, bands like Death Cab for Cutie and Modest Mouse and these sort of indie rock bands, who at the time were just kind of small local Seattle bands, that was also part of that community, and those were our friends, and those were the people who spent a lot of time in the store and who worked there. And it was really fun. And then it really started to work. A couple years later, I think in 2000, we moved just two blocks away, but it was to a very central focal point in the neighborhood. We were at the main intersection, we had a much bigger space, and a lot of things were happening in Seattle. Those bands, the indie rock bands like Modest Mouse and Death Cab, were getting much bigger, and that was kind of the people that hung out in our store. Seattle has a dollar sign because all the tech stuff, there was definitely a big tech bubble in 2000 in Seattle. And we started to get this great press. We were on all these best record stores in America lists, NPR and the New York Times and Rolling Stone. And we got to a point where we opened three stores. We had 23 employees. We had a general manager. People had health insurance. And we were these guys in our 20s that suddenly had what felt like a real business. But it was never as fun as those first couple of years when we were sitting around just with our friends. So having a record store was great for me because I stayed in bands the whole time and I could leave for a month or 6 weeks or whatever and keep going on tour. So I was in other bands that had lots of fun and got to go play shows with Weezer and open for the Pixies. And I was in a band that did a tour of Six Flags amusement parks opening for Sugar Ray, which was really hilarious and fun. And then I was in a band that ended up backing a guy named Tommy Stinson, who was in a band called The Replacements in the 80s and 90s. He put out a solo record. We became his backing band, and that went really well and got to do even more fun things I'd never done. We toured Europe, and we toured in a gigantic tour bus. I don't have a slide, but just imagine something much nicer than that van, like a huge double-decker tour bus. And we played on national TV on the Craig Kilborn show, and there's a very short clip of this. This is pretty rough, but I found it online, so we have to show it. So this is me playing in Tommy Stinson's band in probably 2004. Rock and roll. Oh, thanks. Right around that time, the next year, I finally got to sit down with my father. That's a picture of me and Roy in 2005 or 6, I think. It got to a point where, I mean, he used to come to Seattle pretty often, once every year or two, and I would see the listings, and I would always think, I don't want anything from this person. I've never been mad at him. There wasn't a divorce. He didn't leave us. I always knew about the arrangement he and my mother had. So it kind of just wasn't in my mind. And at some point around then, when I was in my 30s, I think I realized he's almost 70. I'm in my late 30s. There might be things I want to know about his health, about my family, and there might not be another chance. And I see he's coming to Seattle. And so there's a point where I thought it's actually probably time to reach out to him. I was really nervous about it. I talked to my mother first, and I'd never seen her get so protective and so scared and into all this, like, don't do it. He's not going to show up. Even if he says he will, he won't. What, you know, really, like, this version of her I'd never seen. But I decided I had to, so the only thing I could think to do was email his booking agent, who I found online, and it ended up turning into him calling me one day, and we had this great, totally normal phone call and agreed to meet for lunch. And we did, and this is a picture from that lunch, but we went to a restaurant and sat for a couple hours, and I literally took notes. I was writing dates down and writing things down, and we really, I thought, kind of hit it off. It was very light. It wasn't apologetic, because there was nothing to apologize for, and that's not what I wanted. He gave me lots of information. It was crazy to see the mannerisms and the laughs and the things we had in common for someone who hadn't ever been part of my life, how much DNA had obviously come down to me, the stories about music. It all felt very connective and amazing, and I left kind of thinking and saying, you know, this is great. Maybe we can do this once every 6 months or once every year when you're in Seattle or I'm in New York. And that was kind of the plan. But after that, it became very hard, and he would either pick up the phone and be very quick or not pick up the phone, and it just became apparent that he didn't want that. And that was when I finally kind of started to feel angry with my father for the first time, well into my 30s. In 2008, I decided it was time to move back to New York City. I think I was done touring in bands. I was 35, 36. Didn't want to do that anymore. Wanted to step away from the store and really wanted to just get further into the music business, which luckily, between the bands and the store, I'd already had a huge foot in. But New York was definitely the center and the place to do that. And I'd also started my own small record label. I was putting out records by some Seattle bands and some things that had done well. So it really made sense for me to go to New York. And when I got there, my plan had been to not get a job. It had been to do my own thing and try to work my own label. And I ran into some people at a party who told me that the label 4AD, which is a great British label that started in 1980, was looking for somebody to run the US operation. They're based in London. And under any other circumstances, I would have thought, oh, who cares? I'm not looking for a job. But to me, this is the best record label there is. They released records by Pixies and Cocteau Twins and these bands that I loved in high school and college. And we're continuing to release great records, and the fact that I was talking to someone who said, you might be a good fit for this job, was kind of incredible. So I met with this guy, Simon, who runs the company worldwide from London, and had this incredible lunch that was really not a job interview. He never asked for my resume. We just sat and talked about music for a couple hours, and somehow I started this job running 4AD a few weeks later. And it was incredible. We got to work with, I mean, Grimes and the Pixies and St. Vincent and the Breeders and Tune Yards and the National and so many other great bands. Got to do so many fun things. I mean, I don't know how many Coachellas I've been to. We got to go to Saturday Night Live and the Grammys, which I'll be at again, on Sunday. And this was definitely a career high point. I got to give the band Pixies a Platinum Record Award backstage at Madison Square Garden. This is an album that came out in 1989, the year I graduated from high school, one of my favorite albums of all time, and it took that long to sell a million records, but we did, and this is me giving them a record. It's a pretty amazing thing. About 6 years ago, I started writing. That's a typewriter. Clip art. I think it came from, I'd never been a big writer, I'd never been a big reader either, and it started soon after Jason, my partner, and I sold Sonic Boom Records. I left Seattle, he also left Seattle, and that felt like, okay, neither of us is there, it's time to sell the store. And we sold it to a customer, it was a very positive thing, and the way we sort of announced the sale was that I wrote a very short piece for The Stranger, which is like the Seattle Alt Weekly, about those early years of the shared lunches and the rent parties and all that stuff, and published it in The Stranger, and it went really well, and I got lots of compliments, and I realized, oh, wow, this is fun. This is kind of like playing in a band, which I don't do anymore, and, you know, people say nice things to you, and it's kind of like you write something and you put it out there. It's very similar, and it also felt like the writing process was a very similar sort of creative muscle. So I started writing more and publishing some fun things. And it was my wife who finally said, you know, look, you can keep writing about your record store and your band stories and all that stuff, but what you need to write about is your father and your race, because that's what people are interested in, and that's what you're interested in. She was right. And it was a scary thought, but when I really thought about it, and this is crazy because there's lots of people related to these people in this room, I've always known so much about my mother's family. She's really great at staying in touch. It's a big family. A lot of our ancestors had a lot of siblings, and she still, to this day, discovers cousins all the time. I knew my grandparents and my great-grandparents when I was a kid, but I've never known anything about my father's family. And even after that meeting, all I knew was that he had three sisters and that his parents were from Oklahoma, but nothing before that, nothing about his ancestors. And that really bothered me. And so I decided to do 23andMe. And when I did, I didn't learn a whole lot about myself, but I got a family tree from a sort of distant cousin on my father's side who said, I have this Ayers family tree you might be interested in seeing. And he sent me this document, and it was pretty incredible. And it's written by my great uncle, Samuel L. Ayers. He wrote it in 1963, and I'm going to read this in case you can't see it, but this is the opening line that Samuel writes. He said, I don't know how this happened or where he came from, but Isaac Ayers, my grandfather, was a slave owned by Dr. Ayers of Ashland, Mississippi. That really got me, that line, and especially the fact that everyone, including the slave owner, has the same name that I do. That's a really crazy thing to look at on a page and to see my father's name on this tree and all these things. And so I decided I need to learn more about these people. But it was really hard to research the enslaved side, as you can imagine, because there's not a lot of records. People didn't even have names sometimes. But it was very easy to research Dr. Ayers. It was a small town. It was in lots of books. I narrowed it down pretty quickly. And on a website called Find a Grave, I was able to find a woman named Karen Ayers who had left a comment about him. And I assumed she was probably a living descendant of his. And so I emailed her, and I said, hey, you know, I'm not after anything, I'm not mad, you didn't do anything, I'm just trying to find information. And Karen emailed me right back, and sure enough, she's a descendant of this guy, and we started this incredible relationship. That's me, that's Karen. And we just had this amazing email relationship where she was giving me information all the time. It turns out she was a hobby genealogist who knew things about the Ayers farm. She's sending me pictures and documents, telling me stuff about her family. It was really this fascinating thing. And so I wrote about that relationship for NPR's Code Switch, because this is all part of the, you know, researching and writing was all kind of crossing over, and wrote this article, and that spread pretty far. They published it on Thanksgiving, and NPR gave it a big push, so a lot of people saw it, and some of the people that saw it were really close relatives who I didn't realize I had, one of which is my aunt, Michelle. It's my father's sister, who I thought was dead, but was very much alive at the time. As you can see, she has great taste in glasses, too, and could pass for my mother. It's crazy. And suddenly started to meet all these people, their first cousins who I know. All these people live in Los Angeles who didn't know about me, and I didn't know about them, and they're incredibly accepting and welcoming. We have dinner together. We go out. We hang out. We text each other on holidays. And there's all these other people. I mean, these are just pictures from the walls of their houses, but there's all these people I'm related to that I'll never know, but I have these incredible stories. And so I still don't have a relationship with my father, but what I do have is this incredible extended family and this history that I never knew about, and also this side. Your picture is not up there, but I'm very happy about this too. And it's great. And there's a lot more to talk about, bands, record company stuff, father, and ancestors, but it's been a while, so we can open it up to questions, but a lot more is in the book, and I'm happy to hang out and talk and sign books and do whatever. Thank you. Oh.
Nabil, thank you so much for sharing your story.
Thank you.
We do have a few questions, and then if you have any, if you've written any down, just raise your hand. Emily will come around and grab it and bring it up. I'll be reading the questions. Also, if you've thought of any questions while you've been listening to the talk, to the presentation, raise your hand and she can bring you an index card and a pencil and you can jot it down really quick. I forgot to mention we will, and Emily told you when you first came in, be raffling off one copy of Nabil's book tonight. So make sure that you have your raffle tickets. If you don't, again, raise your hand. Emily would be happy to bring you one. But after Q&A, we will we'll do a raffle for one lucky winner. So let me start with the questions. Okay, first question. Do you think that your father, Roy Ayers, has read your book? If so, what do you hope he took away from it?
That is a very common question and a very good question. I don't know. The question is, do you think he's read it? And I don't think he's read it. He's 82. I hear he's got some dementia and isn't doing great, but he's still performing. But I'm not in touch with him. And so much of the book and the thing is about how terrible it feels when I reach out to him and don't get anything back. So when I started thinking, well, this book's coming soon, do I want to get it to him? I thought about the idea of trying to get it to him and not getting anything back, and that just sounded terrible. So I didn't want to do that to myself. So I did email, I call it his real family, because there are two kids after me that actually grew up with him, and I'm in touch with one of them, my half-brother. I emailed him and said, I wrote a book. It's a lot about our father. You're in it. You should let him know I'm not in touch, and if you want me to send it to you, I will. And he replied, LOL, congrats. So that's as far as it's gotten. He didn't ask for it. So I was really nervous during the time when the book wasn't yet out what he might think, like if it was a huge slam piece, but I don't think it is. And to the second part of the question, I hope if he were to read it, he would think, oh, wow, I actually look pretty good in this, because I think he does. Yeah.
I would agree with that. Yeah. And the whole thing is just so matter-of-fact and honest. It's just explaining the story that there's no villain, there's no...
Right,
you know,
right.
So, yeah. What made you decide to write a memoir?
I think it was that conversation with my wife. At the time, I was just writing short articles and publishing them and writing a lot, but I wasn't writing a long thing. And when she said, you should write about your father, I liked the idea. I knew it was going to be hard, but I knew she was right. And I thought, I really didn't know how to do that. I'd only met him a few times. And so I was like, what do I write about? And so I just started writing about each of the times I'd met him, which was, again, a handful. There was a time when I was 5 years old, a time when I was 10 years old. And then I started writing about the times my mother had told me about meeting him that I didn't remember, but there are stories in my head. And then I started writing about, like, that first scene, the many times that I would go someplace and hear his music and what that felt like. And suddenly I realized, oh, wow, this is crazy. I have 20 stories and they're from 2 years old to last year and there's actually a lot here. And I'd also, when I was writing that stuff, I did it so honestly because I was really, really sure that no one would ever see it. And I was really telling myself that. So I wasn't trying to write a book. I was just trying to get to a place where I maybe had one thing that I liked that could be a short piece. But what I ended up doing was realizing, oh, wow, this could be a book. And I don't think any of this would happen if someone had said to me, hey, will you write a book beforehand? There's no way I could have been this honest and free with it.
You are such a gifted writer.
Thank you.
Do you plan to write more books?
That's a good question. I would love to. It feels, I come from playing in bands and putting out records, and so to me it's like, it's been out 6 months, what's next? But I think books aren't as much like that as albums tend to be, so as much as there's a huge part of my brain that feels like I have to do that, it feels like there's so much still happening and I'm still processing this, and so many places that I go, new family members show up. I mean, it's really been crazy how many people I've met. So I think if I had to say yes or no, the answer would be yes, I plan to write another book, but it's not at all like, yes, I'm halfway done and I'll be done by summer. It's not that. It could be a little while, but I would love to.
Are you currently drumming in any bands?
I'm not. I rarely play. I live in New York in an apartment, so I don't have a drum set. I have one set at a friend's house in LA and one set at a friend's house in Nashville. And I play with friends out of town a few times a year, but nothing at all real. I miss it.
If you are a father, did that cause anger towards your father not wanting a close relationship with you?
Meaning if I have a child?
I think so, yes. Yeah, if you are a father, yes.
Right, I see. I don't have children. It is something my wife and I talk about. And a lot of people ask that question. It's just so hard to know, I think, until I actually have a child. It's hard to speculate. I mean, I don't think my father was a bad father. And I think a lot of people think, I do think he was a bad father. He was exactly the father that he agreed to be and that my mother agreed he would be. My uncle was an incredible father, and I hope I would take that influence towards raising a child much more than I would even think about my actual father. But it doesn't scare me. The fact I don't not have kids because I'm scared of being my father, if that makes sense.
It makes sense. It yeah. makes perfect sense. Did your mom ever marry?
Yeah, my mom's been married for 20-something, 30. I mean, right after I got out of college, which was funny because I think I realized at the time, I was like, oh, right, you devoted this whole part of your life to me, and now you can do something for yourself. And that's exactly what it was. She's been happily married for 30 years.
And you consider her husband yeah. a fatherly yeah. figure
He's
to you.
Great, absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Did you always use your father's name? Why did your mom decide this?
That's a good one. There's a short chapter in the book about this. The answer is no. I was born with the last name Braufman, which is my grandparents' name and my mother's name. And when I was towards the end of high school in Salt Lake City, and I knew I was moving to a new city where I didn't know anybody, my mother said, you should change your name. Braufman is a huge pain, B-R-A-U-F, F as in Frank, M-A-N. You have to spell it all the time. I knew it already, and she's like, it's a great time. You're 18, 17, you're moving to a new city, nobody knows you, think about it. And I thought about it, and I liked the idea, and the only thing that popped into my head was, of course, Ayers, because there's an actual connection, otherwise I would have had to make something up. And at the time, this is in 1989, the funny thing is, to me, Roy Ayers was huge in the 60s and 70s. This is the late 80s. I'm in Salt Lake City, where he never came up. Nobody ever asked me in Salt Lake if I was related to Roy Ayers. That stopped when I left New York. And if I did the math, he was almost 50 then. And so in my head, I was like, God, he's an old man. Hasn't been relevant for decades. Like, so there was no part of me that was like, oh, I'm going to attach myself to my famous father. Because to me, he was like done. So it was really just like, it's cool, it's five letters, it's like my first name, which I like, and yeah, let's do it.
We've just got time for these last three, and sorry, I want to make sure that whoever wants to purchase a book has the chance to do that and have Mr. Ayers sign it. Another name question, did both your parents decide on your first name?
Mm. No, Roy had nothing to do with that. My mother and my uncle, it's really my uncle, they were very into the Baha'i faith around this time, which is a religion, and Nabil is a Baha'i name. My uncle read a book called Nabil's Narrative that he loved, and I think it was his idea, and my mother said, yeah, great, that's a good name. And that's what it was. It was some New York hippie stuff.
It is a good name. when your mom told her family that she was dating your dad, did they have any reservations that she wanted a baby with him? And how did they react?
I don't think they knew until she said, you know, I'm pregnant, I'm having Roy's baby. But my mom has an interesting story that I definitely wrote that's not in the book, where that night she met Roy the first time and said to herself, this is the father, she said, this is in the book, she said, here's my address, it's whatever, 46 Downing Street in the Village, come by sometime. And she told me, because I interviewed her, she said, I didn't give him my phone number because I didn't have a phone. Because that was a thing in New York in the 70s. So apparently he came by once, and her father, my grandfather, was visiting. He's from Long Island. He's a lawyer who worked in the city. And as far as, like, if anyone's curious, the race thing, he was a huge civil rights advocate, went to marches in Washington and everything. He's white, obviously. And she was pissed because my grandfather and Roy just hit it off and talked the whole time. And she was like, this is the guy. What are you doing, Dad? So that wasn't so much an issue, but yes, I know they were definitely concerned when she said, I'm 21 years old and I'm pregnant and this guy's deliberately not in the picture. Yes, they were concerned. Yeah.
That's fair.
Yeah.
And then from the same person, the second part, wanting to know, will we see you at the Grammys? Which,
I mean, you won't see me, but I'll be there. I'll be seated watching people do things.
Yeah. Okay, and then our last question for the evening. I think that your mom is amazing, open-hearted, and taught you that what's your relationship with her now?
That is a great question and comment. Thank you. It's great. She lives in, her and her husband live in Park Slope, which is a 20-minute walk from where I am in Brooklyn. I see them all the time. I was telling Terry earlier, she was apprehensive, I think, about what people would think of her in the book for obvious reasons. And when it's mostly gone incredibly well, I think a lot of people see her as the hero, as they should. There was an event in Philadelphia a couple months after the book was out, so there were people there who'd already read it, and there was a line of people to have her sign the book at that event, which was so cool.
So sweet. I just love that.
Yeah, but we have a great relationship. We talk all the time. See each other.
That's great. Well, yeah. Thank you for taking those questions.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody, for coming.
We are going to raffle our book now. And Nabil, if you'd like to do the honors pull the raffle ticket and read the number. Everyone get your raffle tickets out.
That's not the one. Is it the whole thing or just the last numbers?
Read the whole thing.
The whole thing. Okay, 796-7037. 7037.
Oh, really?
Okay. Oh, we got one. 7037. So close.
Yeah. 7967037.
That's the one.
Congratulations. Nabil, thank you. If you'd like to come over here. Thank you all so much for being here. If you'd like to purchase a book and have Nabil sign it, Emily back there is where the line will start. It'll actually run this way outside. And you'll come this way, purchase your book. If you've already purchased a book, you can start a line here, and we just ask that you kind of alternate.